ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Aloha, I'm Rachelle Mansilungan, guest host for the Cyber Underground. Dave Stevens is out of town right now, so I'm here covering for him. And today we kind of have a impromptu change of plans. So originally my guest was supposed to be the CIO of the State of Hawaii Enterprise Technology Services, but he had to get pulled away to a meeting, which is very common for his position. So instead we have Kaimana Bingham. She's actually also works for Enterprise Technology Services, the Office of State of Hawaii. And she's a technical analyst. And she's here to talk about the road mapping, how it's paving the government strategically. Yeah. Correct. And so let's welcome our guest here, Kaimana.
Hi, everyone. Like she said, I'm Kaimana Bingham, and I'm sorry I'm not CIO Todd Nakapui, but I'll do my best to fill in and give some pretty important updates and some pretty exciting news about what's going on in the IT organizations across the state of Hawaii.
Well, thank you for coming. I know it was such a last minute notice, but yes, Todd owes us big time.
Definitely, Todd, if you're watching.
Yes,
you should be in a meeting.
Yes. Could you just talk a little bit about yourself, Kaimana?
Okay, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I have been with the state for about 2 years as a technical analyst. Mm-hmm. I graduated from Virginia Tech, moved out here. I was in the private sector. I actually worked on the Affordable Care Act with a private company. And when the state took over, I did some knowledge transfer for the state, and that's where I met Todd Nakapui. Mm. And he kind of pulled me in and was like, okay, you know, we really need, you know, someone to sort this data for us. How about, you know, you come try the state? And so that's kind of how I got here, and it's been super interesting learning about, you know, just the government and IT, you know, it's so new in the government. You know, the government's been there, it's been established, but it offered me an opportunity to get similar, if not better, experience in than private sector from what he was doing. He took a whole new approach. It's super innovative right now, which is exciting, and he brought in myself and a couple other people on our team. And when we launched this project, we had no idea kind of what to expect from it. One of our huge goals was making it transparent for the public. So that's kind of what I've been working on the past 2 years, year and a half.
Okay. Could we kind of just go back, and maybe the viewers might not be familiar, because I'm kind of familiar because I interned twice for ETS. So yeah. I know you're talking about the road mapping. Could you kind of just elaborate on what that means and for the state and all that?
Yeah, sure. So a pretty broad overview of road mapping is the idea was Todd had, when he came in as a CIO, he had this high-level strategy. And our biggest, hurdle was communicating that to not only the workforce within the state, but to the public as well. So the very first step before we could create roadmaps for the entire state was to create one ourselves. So Todd Nakapui did this very high-level roadmap of the governor's priorities, how ETS's priorities align to the governor's priorities, and our big enterprise projects that align from there. And it was kind of a mix between an organizational chart and strategic goals and where he saw us going.
So prior to this, there was not really a...
No, not. There was nothing published. There might have been a document, you know, somewhere.
Oh, right. I think I've seen that.
Yeah, yes. A pretty lengthy wordy. But visually, you know, at a high level, there wasn't anything that existed that said, hey, this is where we're going for viewers, you know, anywhere to look at. So, like, internally, we didn't really have something that was super evident of where we were going. And externally, especially with the public, you know, we have all these meetings and we go through what we think our strategic plan is, but and we probably have a thick document somewhere of where our strategy is, but nothing at such a high level view where we could communicate it out. So we started there, and so from there, it was a lot easier to show by example what we were expecting from the executive branches as well as internally with ETS itself. So from a strategy standpoint, you know, our Governor Ige has a list of his priorities on his governor website that's available to the public. So we took those And we took our ETS priorities that Todd provided, mm-hmm. and we took our ETS initiatives that aligned with those, and we kind of built out a template for all other department IT branches to follow. So we kind of aligned this.
So like projects and all that?
Yeah, IT projects. Mm-hmm. And we kind of said, okay, here's what ETS is doing. Here's, you know, what we would like to see, how whatever IT projects you have or initiatives coming up, how does that either align with ETS or our governor? So we really wanted a fluid message of, you know, from top down, how we were supporting our governor as an entire state, you know, because there's 18 executive branches.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm sure, you know, from your intern experience,
yes.
you probably know it's really hard to get super involved with those organizations. You know, everyone has their own internal processes. Everyone's so busy, you know, trying to follow and get through their day-to-day, but to track it overall was a huge goal of Todd's. He wanted to see, okay, like, we're all kind of doing, we should be doing the same things.
Mm-hmm.
Let's
all be on the same page. Right,
right. Yeah, let's make sure that we're all doing this for the same reasons and that everyone across the board knows what everyone else is doing and how they align. So it kind of consolidates us, even though we're all separate, you know, and we have our own processes, how to show how we align. And so that was our biggest goal in roadmapping for our IT initiative.
Okay.
So does that make sense?
Does that answer your question?
How we started and kind of what our vision was mm-hmm. in bringing all of the executive departments together, at least from an IT standpoint.
And how did everybody else like take it, like, you know, because it's a new thing for a lot of the departments?
Yeah.
Did they adapt well? Or
so, you know, change always comes with some resistance,
correct.
Right? You know, it was a difficult year trying to get everyone, we put out this new software where we bought licenses for everyone, which is called Sharp Cloud.
Right.
So that's kind of the tool that we used.
And this started what year?
So the roadmap initiative started, I think, a year and a half or 2 years ago. But we implemented Sharp Cloud August 1st was our first rollout. So mm-hmm. everyone had to put their data in. So we tried to make it as user-friendly as possible. Mm-hmm. We knew that it was a new tool and that would take some training. So we went to every department. And for every user who had a license, we provided an in-person training. So that kind of helped the resistance a little bit. And once we could show that there was some value in what they were doing, you know, it really helped. But initially, of course, whenever there's change, there's a little bit of struggle and resistance.
Right.
And it's like, okay, we have a million and one things to do. This is one extra thing that we're kind of already doing, you know, like. So it was a huge challenge at first, but everyone, you know, met compliance. They had a deadline. Every single department met mm-hmm. that deadline, which was awesome. That was like a huge achievement, you know. And they didn't have very long to adapt. You know, it was like a 3 month period where we're like, we're implementing this. This needs to be in by this date, and every single department met that date and that deadline. So that was a huge win, a huge you know, success for us. And we were really stoked on that. So while there was resistance, and you know, it was like you had to kind of walk through and explain, and rightfully so, you know, you're assigning this new workflow, this new process to all these departments, and you know, you see, like,
there's a lot of employees that worked there for years, right?
Yeah, yeah. And so when they're like, you know, we know how this stuff works. Like, you know, we've known this for 10, 15, 20 mm-hmm. years. And I was like, well, I don't. So, like, you know, show me how it works. And that was, it was really incredible to have every department come together and submit their roadmap and really project, like, 5 years out into the future. Because as far as I know, there wasn't a tool that was so easily available where you could say, okay, you're planning this for the next 5 years. And it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, if you plan something in 2020, 2021, that's what's going to happen. But it at least shows what you're thinking about and mm-hmm. the direction you're going, so that, you know, CIO and legislation can see if you're on the right path of, you know, and if those things still align. And it just opens up a lot of communication, which is, you know, kind of hard to get within the state. So that's one of our are huge successes
right.
with using this.
And if you see the program, it's pretty organized. I mean, it's like a virtual thing you could see.
Yeah,
especially if you're like a visual person instead of just reading like a paper.
Right.
You know, I mean, you could see it's colorful and it's on the map. And it goes to each department, correct?
Yeah.
And like even goes to the governor.
Yeah. So for anyone who might be kind of lost, it is on our public-facing website.
Do you want to kind of make a plug for that?
Yeah, so it's
ets.hawaii.gov,
and if you scroll all the way down, it's the ETS dashboard, and you pull it up. There's a little training video that we did on the left that shows you how to navigate the tool, what the filters mean. It shows you kind of how we aligned it with the governor's goals. So definitely check it out.
It's available. It's all public.
So. Yeah, it's all public facing. It lets you know, if you're not aware, we're really trying to get the word out, especially to the public. The ledge has seen a little bit of it, but it's a huge part of our transparency effort. So if you want to see it, you can just go to your browser right now and click on it, watch the video. It's, I think, about 3 minutes, and it tells you how to navigate and get through, you know, pretty much all 18 departments or 16 departments are up. So that's available. I think we published it on the website January 1st.
Okay.
So it's been up for a little while. So if anyone's super curious about this new tool and seeing where our IT organizations are going, you can find it there and email me for questions. My name's attached to the bottom.
I don't know, you said that you also have gone out and given little talks about what you've done.
Yeah,
so
in May or late April, I flew out to a conference in San Diego, and Hawaii right now is the only state using this tool.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So awesome. We actually just won this Chaucer
Digital Innovation
Award. So right now we won that because we were one of the biggest clients and one of the biggest government agencies using this tool. So I went and presented on that. It was a mixture of private sector, other public sector agencies. So I kind of just went through and gave a demonstration of our dashboard. It was a big Q&A where, you know, they could ask questions about how we implemented it, the difficulties we had, and how it was doing for us so far. And so we went to San Diego, won that award. And actually, I think in September, there's going to be a CIO roundtable, and Todd Nakapui might mention that to other states who have expressed interest. I actually spoke to someone from Alaska's enterprise technology. Yeah, they found it. And they found it online, and they reached out and they called us, and it was really funny. They reached out to me personally because they couldn't find my email at first, and they were like, "We really love this tool, and we would love to chat with you and see how you implemented it because our organization is looking to do something similar." And you know, we're working on transparency too, which is like huge right now. So many states are looking to be transparent, you know, and you know, gain trust of the public. Mm-hmm. So this is a way, you know, to do that. And it's just, you know, what we see is out there. And what's cool about it is it's updated in real time.
Oh, okay.
So anytime a department changes a status or a dollar amount within this within their IT roadmap, it rolls up to this dashboard. So it's the most current, up-to-date information that you can get at this time, which is really cool to be able to say, okay, you know, I don't have to wait a month, you know, to see what's going on with this project. It's in real time when the updates are made, they're pushed out, and everything is pretty accurate and holds us pretty accountable, which is something Todd is big on in this IT roadmapping process. So, yeah.
Okay. Did you want to say anything else about it, like a little bit more?
Sure.
Before we go on break.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about more when we come back.
Yeah.
A few seconds.
Yeah. No worries. So another thing that is really cool about it is you don't need a license to be able to go in and view it. So right now we have it not open up to just our users, but anyone who wants to know what's going on in IT, we have a directory So anyone with a Hawaii.gov email can just go in and see what people are in their department are working on. So it's not isolated, it's just from two sources. So you get a lot of feedback.
So, I was about to ask that too.
Yeah, you can get a lot of feedback from, you know, members in your organization who might not actually be putting the data in, but they can review it and process it. So it makes it really open.
Okay. Yeah. So we're going to pay some bills and we'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Pete McGuinness-Mark, and every Monday at 1 o'clock, I'm the host of ThinkTech Hawaii's Research in Manoa. And at that program, we bring to you a whole range of new scientific results from the university, ranging from everything from exploring the solar system to looking at the Earth from space, going underwater, talking about earthquakes and volcanoes, and other things which have a direct relevance not only to Hawaii, but also to our economy. So please try and join me, 1 o'clock on a Monday afternoon for ThinkTech Hawaii's Research in Manoa, and see you then.
Hi, I'm Bill Sharp, host of Asian Review here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Join me every Monday afternoon from 5 to 5:30 Hawaii Standard Time for an insightful discussion of contemporary Asian affairs. There's so much to discuss, and the guests that we have are very, very well informed. Just think, we have the upcoming negotiation between President Trump and Kim Jong-un, the possibility of Xi Jinping, the leader of China, remaining in power forever. We'll see you then.
Hi, welcome back to the Cyber Underground. I'm Rachelle Mansilungan, and I'm here as a guest host. And today I have Kaimana Bingham from the State of Hawaii Office of Enterprise Technology Services.
Yes.
That is such a long thing to say.
It is. It's a mouthful.
All right. So earlier we were talking about road mapping. Right, how it's paving the government. And so I don't know if you wanted to talk a little bit more about like how do you think it's like changing, like, because I know elections is already,
yeah,
you know, tomorrow.
Yeah, so that's a great question. So yeah, in addition to, you know, showing it to our mm-hmm. public, it has a multi-purpose, right? So the dashboard, you know, Todd has been a huge proponent of using it to show to the legislation. So in some of the panels that we have, listed, you know, some of the data that we collect is budget information,
right?
RAG status, which is huge because you want to know whether, you know, your tax dollars are going through a project that is ahead or on track or most importantly behind.
Mm-hmm.
And it allows us to kind of plan out for the future. So say, you know, you spend X amount of money on one project and it's going on for, I don't know, 3 years. And by tracking the status and how much you've spent to that date versus how much, you know, you were appropriated from the legislation, it lets the legislation make decisions, which is important because, you know, you need a high level information, set of information and data that allows people like the ledge to make smart decisions. So in one way, you know, it's making it transparent, but it's also a decision making tool, you know. And internally, it shows, you know, how the workload of the department. So they list everything that they're doing. And if you see that, you know, they have 20 or 30 projects going on in a year, then, you know, you can say, all right, this department is asking for more resources, and they probably need it because look at their workload. Look mm-hmm. at everything they're listing. So it's a huge decision-making tool as well. So the use of it, you know, we have so many audiences that we're trying to cater to with it at a high enough level where it's easy to understand, mm-hmm. So that anyone who, you know, if I wanted to tell my mom, hey, log on and look at where we're going, she could understand it, but also someone who has decision-making power can say it and make smart decisions. And they're getting that input straight from the source, you know,
right,
from the workers who are doing that work every day, you know, and it just opens up communication to ask for more money or, you know, in the opposite sense, if legislation sees that they've allotted this money to a department and they're not spending it or they're not on time, it can make them, you know, rethink if supplemental budget is, mm-hmm. is necessary. So it really just opens up a lot of communication, a lot of voices can be heard by using this tool, which is why we think it's so great. And just by our metrics that we use, they're very simple right now. You know, our RAG status is a huge indicator. We have a timeline view, which, you know, kind of shows how long a project's expected to last. you know, how well it's doing, and then we also have justifications. So we have a reason, you know, for why it's important and why they're doing it, and there's also risks. So like if a department thinks that they have this project that's super important, they want to communicate that to the ledge and the public, then there's reasoning behind it. It's not just, hey, we're going to do this, and you don't have any reason. Why are you? It's not apparent. Just a short little description goes a long ways in informing those decision makers and the public. So using the roadmap, you know, for so many different audiences is challenging, but right. It's I think it's super important in trying to be transparent and adding value to what we're doing. And I know a huge thing that, you know, that Todd relies on it for is cost savings.
And yes, it's all about cost savings.
He's all about cost savings. So aligning that with, in addition to all the great stuff of feedback and return on investment and just transparency in general, he can also, we're doing this deep dive analysis with all of this data, plus some of our internal reporting, to kind of see, okay, now the next step, we have this data, we've collected it, the departments have provided us with really rich information. How can we make their lives better? How can we see, you know, like a PC refresh? And how can we, you know, work on that and bucket these things together, which to this date isn't something that's easily done in the state, if done at all. We're trying to, Office 365. We you were around.
Yes.
Okay, so that was... That was a huge effort, is buying Office 365 for everyone in the state and getting them on the same type of, you know, of software, so that everything, you know, you get better prices, you get support all around. Same with eSign.
Yes.
So it's now we're using that data to identify even more enterprise solutions.
Oh, okay.
So now we can look at the data and say, okay, like how can we help cost savings and get everyone kind of on the same. The same technology that we're using, because it makes it so much easier when you're, you know, doing refreshes or, you know, any type of commodity, really. So identifying those, you know, it's a long and manual process right now, but it's something that we're working towards, so that hopefully at the end of the day, everyone comes together and can, by providing this data, get some valuable feedback and we can show, okay, you know, you provided this, and now we can actually deliver something based on this information that we're collecting. So yeah, that's just one of the many purposes we're using this tool for. So it goes above and beyond just a roadmap.
Do you think it's going to continue? Let's say, what if Governor? No, I'm just hypothetically. Don't get mad at me. Let's say if he doesn't get reelected. I talked about this with Todd.
Yeah.
So what would happen then? Like, say, like, what happened to all you guys? What you guys worked on and.
Yeah. So. I'll go back to when you said if there was a resistance towards this.
Right.
So the first thing that kind of Todd ensured that we did before we even started this was he put it into statute. So now it is in statute, so no matter if it goes across administrations, that departments must submit an IT roadmap over the next 5 years, to 5 years. So that was one hurdle that we could get through, and you know, people were like, well, what if? You know, the new administration just says, you know, they don't want to do this.
Right.
And our response was like, it's in statute, it's here to stay, you know, it'll provide value for your departments and for you, as well as for us. It's a good thing. So that made it a little bit easier to convince, you know, some of the more hesitant people to do it, because it's like, we don't want to do all of this work.
And, for nothing.
You know, and because a lot of our staff has been there and been through that, where, you know, they put so much work into a project, and unfortunately, whether it's political reasons or not, they kind of get swept aside when there's a new priorities come about.
Right.
And we know that that's kind of how it works. So in order to keep this there, that he put it in statute. And the great thing about this is, you know, even if a new governor is elected and his priorities change, it is such a simple and quick task to change those priorities. But also, if it's now justification for why they're doing this, it has all of their work already documented. Mm-hmm. So it's really hard to change initiatives or projects once you can put a dollar amount to it, once you can put actual data into a project, and you're like, hey, you know, you have to provide a really good reason why we should stop working on this project when we've invested X amount of money, you know, when we provided the value, when we provided the resources, and we've allotted X amount of time, right? It makes it a little bit harder to switch up on the workers. And I think that the staff, especially, I know at least feedback in my organization has been, you know, that's great. We don't want, you know, to just stop a project that right. we've been working so hard on. So it kind of gives teeth to what we're doing, because a lot of these workers who have been here, you know, they've seen that, and it's a little bit discouraging,
right? It is.
To say, yeah, hey, I've been working on this for 2 years, and now it's something new. You know,
right.
that kind of. I mean, I haven't experienced that yet, but I imagine, and on the feedback that I've gotten, that would be super frustrating. Mm-hmm. So the way that we kind of try to align it now, not to say that they have to use this tool, but it is, you know, if we get enough feedback and buy-in, it is enough information and enough data that, you know, that provides some backbone to what
right.
they're doing, and a lot of money, and no one wants to lose that much work or
mm-hmm.
you know that much money on an initiative just, you know, for reasons that aren't, you know, 100% valid. So that's kind of how we approach this, and making sure that it wasn't just a task that they're doing for
right.
you know for 2 years and then it gets wiped. Todd was really strategic in working to make, he thinks it's really important, and he values, I think, all the work that the staff does put in, and
yes.
it should be recognized across administrations, you know, whether he's here or new governor, new CIO, that work should definitely be validated. And this is one of the ways that we're trying to do that for our organization and ETS, as well as department organizations.
Are there any other, I know that Todd has a lot of projects, initiatives. Are there any other future ones that you know of that?
I know he has his hands pretty full with payroll right
oh,
now.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that's a big one, and I think...
A modernization.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember that.
So, I know that that's his big project that he's been focusing a lot of attention on. I think that we've been pretty successful in enrolling at least in ETS, and
right.
I think the other executive departments, he's been working really hard in making sure our new payroll system is, you know, up to date and on track, at least, or getting on track. So that's probably the biggest focus he has right now.
Okay.
I'm not super involved with it. I look at their roadmap every now and then, but I let him handle those big ones. So
right.
That's I would say one of his top priorities right now is making sure that that's a smooth transition, because you don't want a bunch of
yes,
workers
indeed.
Not getting paid. That would be like any CIO or manager's worst nightmare.
Well, Kaimana, it was great to have you here representing
you.
Todd Nakapwe for the State of Hawaii Office of Enterprise Technology Services. And
yeah.
if you guys wanted to check out, again, their website, they also have a newsletter.
Yep. We have an internal one that's the How's It one.
Yeah, the How's It one.
Yeah.
So you can sign up, you can subscribe to that, I do. Or you could also go to their website, which is ets.hawaii.gov.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm Rachelle Mansilungan. Until then, stay safe. And this is the Cyber Underground. Aloha.